Church, praise the Lord. All right, give a shout out. Give a shout out. Because you know, we have these meetings in locations that we don't pay for. We don't have a budget for. So we have to rely on the decency, the kindness of those individuals and those locations that will allow us an opportunity to have this many people on a Saturday morning come to their space. So we want to say thank you to the church for allowing us to be here. Y'all give it up. Give it up. Give it up. And we want to thank Paul Deacon Brian here to give you a little information about the church. It's Deacon Brian. Give it up. There he comes in the back. Oh, he got the memo too. Look at him. He got his Navy shirt on. Blue jeans. I'm out. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Deacon Harris. We'd just like to welcome you to Historic St. James Missionary Baptist Church, where we love God, we love our church, and we love each other. We are grateful that you decided to host your meeting here in District 1, and we'd just like to know that we're here for anything we can do to help you. So feel free to contact us. We'd like to contact you when we need some services. And I'd just like to welcome Councilman Tate and his staff here, and I just hope you have a wonderful and productive meeting. Thank you.
And we want to thank you again. So, Pastor, if he doesn't, because I don't know Pastor's on his way, so he's here. It's the mic's here, of course. This is his house. So, how many of you coming up next on the agenda? How many of you ever been to one of our most phenomenal events in District 1 that we've held now for 6 years, Sidewalk Fest? Come on, man. I know some more of y'all doing Sidewalk Fest. You haven't. Oh, well, today is your special day. This year will be an opportunity to actually go for the first time. We have today the founder and the director of Sidewalk Fest, Ms. Ryan Myers Johnson. Ryan, if we should hear. Oh, come on up. Come on up. Y'all give it to her like you want to go, y'all. All right. So, this is a phenomenal event that takes place on off of Grand River. And let's talk to folks a little bit about Sidewalk Fest. Why don't you start?
Cool. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
So as you said, I'm Ryan Myers Johnson. I'm the director and curator of Sidewalk Festival. And we're entering into our 6th year. It happens on Lost River between Grand River and Orchard Street. And it's a festival of performing and visual arts. So we have over 50 artist groups, which totals almost 200 individual artists coming out to do work that's socially relevant and that's in non-traditional spaces. So we're doing performances in the street, in the art alley, and in some of the storefronts of the businesses on Lost River and Grand River. So you'll see dance, music, theater, installation art, live mural painting, and a lot of things are interactive. We have a lot of activities for youth and for children. Vendors selling food and local jewelry making, all sorts of really wonderful fun things. And this year we're actually doing a panel discussion as well on the Friday night. So the dates are August 34th, and on August 3rd, we've invited some of the local business owners, Sweet Potato Sensations and Motor City Java House, to have a dialogue with some of the new developers that are in the neighborhood. So what does all this mean? What does all this new development mean? So we just wanna have a conversation where community members can pose those questions and their concerns. So that's gonna be Friday night at 7 p.m. That's next Friday. So we really hope that community members will come out and in general, just come out and have fun with us. Are you playing that video?
Yeah,
okay, well the video will show you all sorts of things, what the festival looks like. while they're doing that, I was curious, does anyone have any questions about the Sidewalk Festival? Or, there's a bunch of flyers in the back on our back table.
Any other questions, Brian?
Time frame.
So,
what's the time frame?
It's Friday from 7 to 10 p.m. And on Friday, it's just within the Artist Village and the Art Alley, so we won't have a street closure, but you can park at the Oleb Nakuda and then go into the Motor City Java House, and there'll be probably about 6 to 10 performances that happen at night, spoken word, poetry, dance, theater, as well as a panel discussion. And then on Saturday, it's from 3 to 10 p.m., and that's all throughout Lasseter, a little bit on Redford Street and throughout the Artist Village.
And I know there's an old Redford Business Association is looking to come back. Are you a part of the association?
Yeah, I am a part of the Old Redford Business Association, and the founders of the Old Redford Business Association will be on that panel on Friday night.
So I bring up this association because, if you listen, ladies and gentlemen, there's a lot of development that's about to take place over in Old Redford. A lot of development. There's an individual who purchased about, I think, 3 or 4 pieces of land, very important pieces of land over there. And it's important for the businesses who are already in that area to strengthen themselves before that development begins. They've been there all these years. They've held it up all these years. And they have to be a part of the process as we move forward. So we're going to give all the strength and love to the business association who's currently in place, but also support those who are willing to come into our community and invest. Yes.
To echo what Councilperson Tate said, we've invited that developer to have a dialogue with the Old Redford Business Association and with community members. So please come out on that Friday at 7 to make your voice heard as well.
Good morning. Thank you so much for this opportunity to share the fact that I'm volunteering. And are you still in need of volunteers?
Yes, thank you for bringing that up. Oh my God. So she's volunteering. Yes, we need volunteers. There's with like over 200 artists kind of roaming around the whole place. We need a lot of volunteers. So usually we try to get, you know, upwards to 40 or 50 volunteers, but we usually have about 30. So if you want to volunteer, I'll leave my business cards as well, like at the desk. So just grab one and or email us at ryan@sidewalkdetroit.com.
All right, so I think we're ready for the video. Original.
Outside here so that everybody can get exposure to it and inspire people a little bit of, I guess, your attention.
events begin August 3rd and 4th, Friday and Saturday. And if you want to see the full lineup of the artists, go to our website at sidewalkdetroit.com. You can send an email to us there, or you can find me on Facebook. Friend me on Facebook, please, at Ryan Myers Johnson, or follow our Facebook. Thanks.
All right, y'all give it up for Ryan Myers Johnson. You said you got to say it 7 times to get into the brand. Take it ready. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Coming up next is the D1 Youth Spotlight, a part of the meeting that I love because we get an opportunity to love on our young folks in the community. We have a very special guest today with us. We have a very young, special young lady, Miss Michaela Johnson. If you could please come forward, please. Y'all give it up. And as you see, as this young lady comes forward, tell you a little bit about her and why she's joining us today. She is a Cass Tech High School student. She'll be a senior this fall. DCT folks in the house? There's some of y'all already in the room somewhere. She has a 3.5 GPA. Give it up. That ain't easy nowadays. She's going to be an actress. Her favorite subject is English. She's vice president for Cass Tech's Performing Arts Guild for the 2017-18 season. She's also part of the My School's Academics Games team. She's the main stage actor for the Mosaic Young Theater of Detroit. And in her spare time, she volunteers as a junior coach for Think Detroit Pals Northwest Cougars. Now you see why I had to write all this down. So we want to perform to you with before you today a scene from the classic play Fences. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
So how long have you been an actress? Or wanted to be an actress?
I always wanted to be an actress when I was a little kid. I always used to like play around and act like I was like different people. I said I always wanted to be an actress when I was a little kid, and then getting to cast and being the trainee that I need really helped me to figure out that that's what I want to do in my life.
So who was your favorite character to play with? Was it like a superhero or a princess?
No, I really like Hannah Montana, so I always like used to run around the house and sing like her, and I asked my mom to buy me like a blonde wig and everything.
So, you know, blonde wig is in nowadays. Have you ever sport that look at all? Okay, all right. Now, I say we might have an intervention over here on the side. But we want you to go ahead and do what you do here before the D1 audience, and y'all are going to be blown away. I have not seen her do her thing, but I've seen it be all of the rave reviews that she has received. So you all give it up for Michaela Johnson, who's going to give you a scene from Fences.
Absolute quiet.
Don't you?
the phone. This is the Lord that you want to bow up here. This is why we have these meetings. This is why we showcase and highlight what's really in our community. Because if you just watch the news, you don't see this. And I'm not bashing anybody, but we've got to do more to highlight young ladies like this, young men in our community like this, and give them the things that they need to succeed as a community. So we would like to provide you this is a phenomenal performance, right? If you can, we don't ever like to let our youth leave here empty-handed, but we want to show you something from the city side. So we have, on behalf of the City of Detroit, signed by all the members of the City Council, an award of recognition for Ms. Michaela Johnson, ladies and gentlemen. Y'all give it up for Michaela Johnson. I know sometimes those hours that it takes to spend listening, going through with her, and going to the training and the courses, I know that's sometimes a little challenge for you as well.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Took her every single day, either with dancing, singing, piano lesson, acting classes at Mosaic. So, yeah, it was very stressful all day, every day.
So this is not just for Makayla, this is also for you as well, for the work and the love that you poured into this phenomenal young lady. Y'all give it up again for Ms. Michaela Johnson, ladies and gentlemen. So now, many times we have, and for the most part we have, presentations that are specific to District 1. We have, maybe it's a street or a program or a plan that's happening solely in District 1. Well, this next topic is a topic that is not just in District 1, it's one that is throughout this city, throughout this country, throughout this world, unfortunately. We're talking about sexual assault. And it's important for us to understand that it's an issue that we all have to either be aware of, to first know what to do, but then take action if we have an opportunity to do so. And today I want to bring to you a young lady who I've known for a very long time in the police department when I was there. She's a phenomenal individual, that's the word of the day. Phenomenal women is who we have before us. We have Officer Vieira Brown Lee. Give it up for Officer Vieira Brown Lee. I know it's a tough topic to talk about. It looks like from the numbers that we've seen, that you provided us, that the numbers from this year in terms of reported criminal and sexual assault crimes have actually gone down year to date.
Absolutely.
Versus past years. Do you know what that's attributed to?
I think that basically that a little bit more awareness is coming out in the public to talk about sexual abuse. I think the Me Too movement kind of encouraged people to speak up a little bit more. And I think that continue to do those things, and that's why I'm here today to talk about education awareness. We can get those numbers down a little bit more.
Okay. Well, I won't take up any more of your time.
I just don't know why you have to come after this beautiful young lady.
That's
how you follow up behind that.
That's why you need to get interviews.
Hi, good morning, everyone. Everybody looks so lovely, Councilman. I'm Officer Brownlee of Detroit Police Department. I've been a police officer for 20 years. I've been assigned to sex crimes 2.5 years now, and we have three squads there. What we do there basically is investigate sexual abuse, sexual assaults in the city of Detroit. I'm on a kiddie squad. We have a kiddie squad, we have an unknown squad, and we have an adult squad. Of course, unknown are those who may be walking down the street, and somebody jump out of the bushes, or they get kidnapped and they get sexually assaulted, or they may be at a party, and which is often, and they get a little too intoxicated or use drugs and they fall out and they don't know what happened to them and they wake up and their clothes are off. And then you have the known squad. Sometimes it's a husband, sometimes it's a boyfriend, sometimes it's a friend, they say no and they force themselves on them. So it's three different categories we have as sex crimes that we investigate. First of all, who, be honest, who's in here? Not sex crimes. Who in here is comfortable talking about sex right now? Just sex by itself. You comfortable saying anything and everything about sex right now? Everything. Everything? Okay. I only see a few hands, and that's how children feel. Who wants to talk about sex? This is why this sexual assault and child assault thing is very, very, very quiet. I call it the silent crime, because no one wants to talk about it. Okay? You know we all come from a history. Don't say that uncle did that. Don't, we're going to keep that in the family. We're not going to talk about that. That's common. Okay? So, right now, today, I'm just going to give you a little bit of education, and I'm going to tell you how we operate at Detroit Police Department. There's only four ways we get reports. You can go into a, you cannot report a sex crime over the phone. You have to go inside of a prison, okay? In addition to that, you have referrals. CPS, they referral, they get complaints about children being sexually assaulted, because I only deal with children. You have Detroit Public School, and you have a hospital. Those are the three referrals that we get the most, or someone going inside a precinct, or a scout car being called out to your car. I'm not sure if you guys know this, but it's basically against the law to have sex under 15. Okay? You cannot have sex under the age of 15. A 15-year-old and under cannot consent to have sex with anyone. A 16 can consent, a 16 and up. However, if you're 17, 16 or 17, and you're in a situation and you have a teacher or a boss or someone of an authority, that's a sex crime too. No one in a position of authority can have sex with anyone 17 and under. So in saying that, you have a lot of issues where we have 15-year-old girls having sex with 17-year-old boys because that's their boyfriends. What's 2 years? 2 years is really nothing. So if a parent gets upset at that 17-year-old for messing with his daughter, they come and they report. And if there's any penetration, that young man is going to have to get arrested. There's no doubt about it. Because the 15 cannot consent. So my issue is that there's a lack of education about child sexual abuse. No one's talking about it. We need to talk to it more about our children, our grandchildren. We need to be careful with who house we send them over. We need to be careful who latch we allow them to sit on. If you see it, and it feel like it's not right, then it's not right. Okay? And you have to put a stop to it. You tell somebody else to put a stop to it. So right now, we have four degrees of sex crimes, and the technical name is criminal sexual conduct. You have 1, 2, 3, and 4. CSC 1 and 3 is your felonies. Those involved with penetration, maybe a gun is involved, a weapon is involved, and then you have your 2 and your 4, which involve with contact, fondling, maybe pornography, things of that nature. Secret 101. for the Detroit Police Department, right now what we're doing an educational piece. We're putting together a Hush No More initiative, which it's like an education, awareness, prevention program where we go out, we're going to go to the schools, and you guys are going to see it, so you're going to come here as well. We're at the planning stage of that, and we're going to implement an education and prevention and awareness so we can get everybody on board to get more involved in intrusive sexual assaults. We want everybody to be aware. We want everyone to put your children in on this. We really want this thing to stop. So we don't want them to hush no more. We want them to speak up. So I want you guys to continue, please, to pay attention to all the children around. If there's anything you see that doesn't feel right, if there's anything that you see that makes you feel uncomfortable, if you get intuition and it's not right, please do something about it. If there's a sexual assault that occurs that you know, and tell everyone else to go to the police station immediately, and we'll be sure to make sure we do the best we can to come and get these people and take these pedophiles and put them up. We appreciate everything you guys are doing. Thank you so much.
Because that can make the difference between a criminal sexual conduct 1 or 4 if a child can or cannot describe what's going on. Am I telling the truth?
Yeah.
And so, how many people in the room comfortable with saying the word vagina? Can I hear you say it?
Vagina.
Penis.
Penis.
Anus.
Anus.
Breast.
Breast.
Buttocks.
Buttocks.
Real easy. As soon as you start teaching your children how to say ears, nose, mouth, and all of that, it's not a pocketbook, it's not a wee wee, it's not a thang thang. Who in you guilty of doing it, okay? Am I the only one? I know I'm not the only one. So, here's why I started the Sasha Center. Truth be told, I was a victim of sexual assault by a female cousin from the time I was 5 years old until I was 9. What happened was she was also being sexually molested by her mother's boyfriend. So we got to talk about this family dynamics and the generational pieces that come with being sexually assaulted. And the silence in the African American community is real. We're not talking. What goes on in this house? How y'all know that? Everybody knows it, right? And here's the thing. In slavery, what goes on in this slave house needs to stay in this slave house. Used to be functional for us. It used to work, right? But then as generations kept going on, the whole thing has become what we keep in all these secrets in our house. And Dr. Joy DeGruy says it best. Secrets make us sick, y'all. Secrets make us sick. And so as a result of being a victim of child molestation, that put me at risk, and I became a sexual assault victim on the first date with somebody when I was 15. Then I was sexually assaulted again by a so-called boyfriend, and all of that happened before the age of 21. So when I went to the School of Social Work after dropping out of high school, doing drugs, fighting, doing all this other stuff, by the time I got to college, thank God I got to college, right? I decided that I wanted to work with this population specifically. And what I found was that in our communities, even amongst ourselves, survivors of sexual assault get treated very differently depending on how they present in a room. So there's two things that happens in community that we need to talk about and that we really need to remember. One is rape culture. Rape culture is a culture in this country that makes rape okay in jokes, on television, on memes, on social media, and it's like, we're just joking. We're just playing. No, we're not playing, because what happens is, even in our music, every day I gotta listen to rape music, and that can come in the form of rap or country or rock and roll, where there is a deliberate misogyny and deliberate hatred towards women. And so what we know is that by the time you're inundated with that, because music happens to be the soundtrack of our lives, we'll hear one song 100 times before we watch a movie 100 times. It'll change the way you think and see women. It will. And I'm going to tell you something about the Sasha Center that I'm so proud of. First of all, I want to say that what we know is that most men in our communities do not commit sexual abuse and assault. Most men are very good men in our community. Here is where Sasha Center steps in when it comes to having conversations with men. Because first of all, we haven't created enough safe spaces for men to talk about what's happening to them if they've ever been sexually abused and assaulted. And I'm saying to you now, break the silence, because it's going to hurt you. Break the silence because it will heal you. Trust me when I tell you that. But one of the things that we know is that good intended men in this room who know better, who would never do anything like this to a survivor or to a person or to a woman or to anybody, y'all not having conversations with the men you know who do. So every man in this room knows somebody at risk of committing sexual assault, of committing domestic violence. And so we have programming, we have male facilitators that talk and have conversation with men. We just did this at my sorority, Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated. I want to say what's up to my fans. Hey, fans. We just had an all-male conversation at the Delta House right on Lassa. We did. And then I want to thank you, Councilmember Tate, because you haven't missed anything that the Sasha Center has done for the last 6 years. And I love you for that. And I love you for the resolution that's in the back of the room that supported all of our organizations when I led the actual protest of R. Kelly downtown in LCA. Yes, I did. I led that conversation. And what we know is it's not just about the artists. It's really about us having conversation. Because what we do is we treat R. Kelly just like we treat the same uncle in our family. Look, baby, we know he ain't right. He feel a little strange. Keep the babies away from him, right? Or her, because y'all heard my story. Or her. See, sexual assault is about power and control. So at the Sasha Center, what we have done is something very innovative, something that is not happening anywhere in the country, nowhere. Now, I'm not proud of that. That means we have work to do. What we have done is we create safe spaces for survivors of sexual assault to come and tell their story. We don't know how black women particularly have been healing from sexual abuse and assault. We don't know. But what we do know is that y'all have been healing. And what we want to know is how have you been doing that so you can share with younger sisters. So we'll have a group, because we only service people 16 and up. We don't have a group of survivors. Somebody 16 years old in the room, somebody 60, somebody 88 years old in the room, telling their stories for the very first time because the silence in our community has been too real. So Sasha Center specifically does prevention and education. We partner with organizations, so right now we have a group that's going on at Salvation Army, Payne Pulliam School, and we just started to flip the script at Goodwill Industries. But we also have our own support group session that happens once a month at Tech Town at 5:30 in the afternoon. All you have to do is call the 800 number, and you can definitely register for that particular group. It's called the Healing is Possible group. We are also on every piece of social media that you can find. We've partnered with the DIA. We have taken survivors of sexual assault on the Underground Railroad tour because we also believe that culture cures, and we also know that history heals. If you don't know where you're coming from, there's no way you can know where you're going. Amen? And so in order for us to heal as a community, in order for us to begin to talk about this, we have to first break the silence. And breaking the silence can be anything from telling somebody, here, let me leave y'all with a couple of things that you can do. First of all, be somebody that a survivor or a victim of sexual assault can come and talk to. And the way that you do that is you change how you think about how sexual assault happens. You change how, you change how you see sexual assault victims. The first thing that you can do, and y'all repeat after me, say this, I believe you. It's not your fault. And how can I help? Not let's go ride down on them. Not let's go get you a PPO, call the police right away. We want you to call the police because we're trying to catch perpetrators. But I'm going to tell you something. A lot of survivors do not and have not been engaging with the police. That does not mean that they don't have healing. That does not mean that they cannot be treated with dignity and respect. That does not mean that you can't believe them. But see, the first thing a survivor will do is keep it to themselves if you ask them, well, what should you have on? Why were you over there at 2 o'clock in the morning? What was you smoking? Because at the end of the day, she can be butt naked, smoking, spinning in a circle, and we assume that men are animals and won't take care of her. That's two problems. Men are not animals, and that they can take care of people. You know that. And then two, if she out here butt naked, grab her a coat and put it on her and tell her to call Sasha Center. We'll work with her around all those issues. But we also know that there's sometimes that this thing is systematic. So those are the things I want y'all to understand. The other thing I want you to understand is that if you want to reach out to us, it's sashacenter.org is the website. We're on Twitter. We got two Twitter pages because my interns say I'll be posting whack stuff, so whatever. But my interns, they like to post recent stuff. So we got two Twitter pages. We also have an Instagram page. And I think we got about 2 minutes left. So what I want to do is kind of turn this over if anybody has a question or a comment. But family, I'm so honored to be here. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. I just want to turn it over for a question.
Yes, and what we're going to do is also, we're also going to bring up Officer Brown Lee.
Yes, please, come up.
It's that time for Q&A, and you guys stay up there.
And also, while Officer Brownlee is making her way up here, we have brochures that explain to you our programming. We also have a really quick handout that explains our Healing is Possible. And what y'all need to understand is that Sasha Center is an organization that allows space for everyone. Everyone. Meaning that if you identify as LGBTQ, if you identify as Christian, if you identify as an atheist, you need a Bible, we got that. You need a chicken foot, we got that too. Because we ain't scared. Because this healing is so much more important than all those other markers of difference. So, thank you.
We have one over here.
Thank you so much, Sarah, and police officer. When I saw the council member's agenda, I was ready to come here to talk about human trafficking. And I know seven wards on human trafficking. I am just African. I'm an adult and I've been there. But I am absolutely enthralled that you two ladies are positioning yourself, whereas our young ladies and your men will have a format and a platform to come to you and to get some relief. Thank you so much for this presentation, Councilmember Taffer, Taylor Staff. Thank you so much.
Well, one of the things I want to say about happening in our community. Sasha Center is specifically focused on African American women in the southeastern Michigan area who are direct descendants of slaves and are here as a result of the migration from the south to the north. And we know that sexual assault is happening in the context of our families, our friends, the people we know, the people we love. And I am saying that the job of all of us, if this has happened to you, is integration. We know you ain't gonna never be able to forget it. And I know a lot of my cousins, and me too, try to forget it, but then something will come up and hit you in the back of your neck, like a smell, a color, or something like that. And we've had survivors go to job interviews, and because the interviewer had on brown, she couldn't finish the interview. You know what that means? She couldn't get a job. We're trying to make sure that we get those triggers out the way and help people manage their triggers so that they can be the best thing that God intended them to be. So thank you.
Same set that's of harassment. Not that many people are talking about it.
Absolutely. You know, it's about power and control. And it doesn't matter if the person is male or female or what have you. Sexual abuse and assault happens when people want to have power and control over other people. It's not about sex, y'all. It's about power and control. And absolutely, that can happen in many dynamics. Thank you.
We have one over here.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. I work for Detroit Public Schools in a K-8 school, and this is my first year being back from many years ago. And I am seeing firsthand in my school, girls and boys interacting in a lot of gay-type, you know, sexual, I hope I'm saying the right word, I don't want to offend anybody. But I've seen a lot of girl-on-girl stuff, they're catching boy-on-boy stuff in our bathrooms, and it's just like prevalent. It is so much every day, even third graders. Is there anything you can do with Detroit Public Schools or have some type of recourse? I'm going to say something really quick. It's just not enough time in the day for me to just touch on everything that I've covered in an 8-hour day. However, I'm going to say this. With kid-on-kid, assaults are higher than an adult and kid. So I have a lot of kid-on-kid reports where kids are touching other kids. So I'm going to let her speak, but I think that the curiosity, them being sexually assaulted, like she said, they're kind of carrying that on to another kid. Also, we have the internet, we have the media, so much sexual education out there is misleading kids to be a little bit more Christian. Like she said, the songs, all these little media folks, yeah, they're exposed to so much. So obviously, I know the sexual abuse rate on kid on kid is something different. I'm gonna let her sleep on that, but I do wanna let you guys know our kid on kid reports are higher than an adult on kid reports.
Thank you for sharing that. The other thing I want to do is I saw this as an opportunity to dispel a myth in the Black community particularly. And that is, if a child is being sexually molested, that does not mean that they're going to grow up to be gay, lesbian, bisexual, or trans. We really got to stop doing that. Orientation is something totally different than trauma. And stop trying to apply trauma to that community specifically. I want y'all to be really clear about that. Here's how I know that that is a myth. We got a lot of straight people who were sexually abused as children. And so with that notion, with that knowledge, you have to understand and know that orientation is fueled by something else. But in addition to that, we, like she said, children are being exposed to sex so much sooner, and that some of them are experimenting and doing things that they've seen their parents doing. We don't have at home anymore any kind of boundaries. You know, we're doing all kind of stuff in front of our children, and we have to stop that. And so we also know that when children are acting out, it is always a symptom to what's happening at home. And so we have to educate our principals, our teachers, our counselors, our parents, and then love the children as well, all at the same time. But it is a problem, and definitely me and my co-partner here, we're going to get together and get that hush program going, and we're going to come to the schools and make sure that we have that conversation.
Hello, thank you. I'm a survivor. We had people in the house. You know, it's super different, first cousin, second cousin, those every small cell survivor. But what I didn't know was the range that you carry along with years.
Yes.
And so then when I hear girls scream, it's a certain pitch that they reach. And the drugs are just a bad thing. All of this, I'm so glad you're doing holistic. Because it's the whole person. And when you hear that pitch, you know what it is.
Absolutely. And thank you for sharing that. One of the other things I want to say is that we recognize that this conversation is a heavy one. Right, family? I just want us to make a pact in this room right now. When you leave here, please take care of yourself. Play with a baby, play some good music, whatever you need to do. Cook yourself a good meal, take a walk, drink some water. Take care of yourself, burn some sage, light a candle, read a scripture. Do something to take care of yourself, because we recognize that this is a tough conversation. But we also have resources available in the back. There's an 800 number here for the Sasha Center, but also there's a 24-hour crisis line you can call. If you don't have the information now, you can look up RAIN on your phone, but please make sure you take care of yourself.
We also do have information back there from the Detroit Police Department. My contact information is back there on Camden. You can get in touch with our office back there. I have some human trafficking information back there as well. So if you go back on the table, you will see different campus information and resources from the Detroit Police Department in this issue.
So we want to thank
my question is, do you need volunteers, and why, how do I go about becoming a volunteer?
Yes, we actually do always need volunteers at the Sasha Center, and what you can do is call our 800 number. It's right there on the brochure, 888-865-7055. Now, there's a lot of places that we need volunteers at. We need administrative help, we need board help, and all those things, but our time is up right now. But definitely make sure we talk after we leave. And I'm a hugger, by the way. I'm letting y'all know that now. If you're not a hugger, don't come my way. And if you're not a hugger, you can give me the elbow or fist. But I will get consent first. But I'm so happy and so proud of y'all for getting to this. Y'all did a great job. Thank you.
I want to thank you all once again. Because the councilman, people always say this. As a councilman, people believe that you're like a Superman, that you can, like, do all the things and take care of all the problems, all the issues, but we can't. And so we have to make sure that we rely on our community partners while we're doing this on a daily basis and bring them to you in terms of resources and utilizing the everything that they have to offer to the community. Ms. Kalima, my apologies again. Is it okay to talk about what you want to fly around the country? Okay, I'm gonna let you know how special this June is in our community. So not only is she here, no, look at Vieira Johnson, ladies and gentlemen. Bradley. So tell us a little bit about what you fly around the country and do.
Oh yeah, so I am the lead relations here. You come right up here. Because I mean, we can't do this without sisters, right? Got to always have to thank. But actually, one of the things that God has blessed me to do, and God knows I don't even know how I got in it. I kind of know, but I'm thankful. So I am the lead consultant on relationship management and safety for the National Basketball Association, the National Football League, and the National Hockey League. So I have these conversations in male space all the time. And what my responsibility is, especially with the NBA, because I spend way more time with NBA players than I do any other players, is to make sure that they transition into, participate, and transition out of this game whole. They're going to only be in the game, most on average, 3 to 5 years. We want to make sure that their relationships are managed and healthy and well. But I also talk to them about becoming ambassadors to teach other men how to treat women and girls. And so in that capacity, I've just trained the entire NBA staff, not just players, but the whole staff on sexual harassment as well.
And I just want to let y'all know, and that's what we have right here, once again, in our Detroit community, Detroit. All right, thank you all so much. Once again, as I said, this is the day that the women rule. This is Woman Power today. And we have a young lady that's going to come before you, Miss Patience Ward. She's not going to come up first. Before she comes up, we're going to have a video that Reggie put together over the location in District 1. How many of you have heard of Happy Hollow? I know you've heard of Hungry Hollow. I know you've heard of Hungry Hollow. But this is a little bit different. This is Happy Hollow. Now, Happy Hollow, Happy Hollow is a company that makes dog treats, natural, holistic dog treats, right here in the city of Detroit, but not just in the city of Detroit, in District 1. Located right on, it's on Dale Street, right? It's on Dale Street. So for 10 years, have been in District 1. Before it was Happy Hollows, it was another company that did like pig ears, I think, right, for pets. So it's been transitioning over the years, so now they're in a position where they make, instead of pig ears, natural, holistic, there's some meat in it, but you'll see, there's some stuff, and what I'm about to the factory that looked like it would be on basically the menus of folks in the community. So not just our community, the entire community. Great job with the quality control that you all do. So Reggie, if you play the video. Abatements and things of those natures, we can use those in our neighborhoods as well. And so this is an organization, a company that can benefit from some of the same things that we have in downtown. And I know this as the chairman of the Planning and Economic Development Standing Committee. So we're going to do all we can to make sure that we give you all the same advantages that we provide those companies in downtown Detroit. So we have it right here in District 1. That's a hand clap for somebody, please. All right. All right. Let's make some noise. Tell us about Happy Encounter.
First started 3.5 years ago, it was only 6 employees working there. We have hired over 20 employees in the inner city. Our goal is to hire at least 1,000 in the next 7 years. Local shelters and go to different pet stores in the city, pass out free treats, and just help the community.
Now, Patience, how long have you been with the company? So, I know you said you're hiring a lot of Detroiters, right?
Yes.
So, how many Detroiters?
Over 20.
Over 20. So, how long have you been with the company?
3.5 years.
3.5 years. And what's been your experience as a member of Happy Hours? Come on.
I love it. I started off in packaging. Then I worked my way into making the treats in the kitchen. And after I learned how to make the treats, clean the treats, I moved up to customer service. So I do all the online marketing, answer all the customers' questions and concerns. I ship out all the treats online. I visit different stores, pass out treats, go to the local shelters, see what they need as far as donations.
Now, when I asked patients over on the corner, I said, do you have any samples that we can provide? And she said she didn't bring any today.
No, I'm sorry.
But if somebody says they come from District 1 and came from me, I'm sure you guys can give a little something.
Yes.
Take away with you. Okay. What's your location over on Dale Street?
15510.
And you have 4,000, I believe, stores nationwide, correct? 4,000. Where can they find you? So it's not really a retail. Let us see what you guys got for what local so you guys are not located. It's not a retail where you would go and just walk up and just buy the product. It's one where you actually wholesale it and send it out to other companies, right?
And we also have our treats at Pet Supplies Plus all locations.
So I think the nearest Pet Supplies Plus is the one on Telegraph.
Yes.
Telegraph from 96 over there. All right, so Patience Ward, thank you so much for being here. This is part of our Discover D1 initiative. Something that's fun.
Thank you for having me.
This is part of our Discover D1 initiative. So this is what, once again, we talk about all the stuff that's happening in downtown, midtown, and now Corktown. A lot of stuff happening. There's a lot of stuff happening in our neighborhoods as well. And it's a matter of us making sure that we show love to the businesses that are located within our communities, because the reality is a lot of that stuff that you see down there, and I'm telling you this, a lot of that stuff that you see down there in downtown and midtown and Corktown is coming to our town. It's not ready yet. It's some time. But one day you're going to wake up and it's going to be boom. And the question is, are you going to be in place? Are you going to be in the right place to take advantage of the situation? So that's why I'm asking you right now. That's why we have these programs come before you in this presentation. And so we want home ownership as well in the city of Detroit. At one point in time, the city of Detroit had the highest home owner rate of Black Americans in the country. that's not the case anymore. We have a lot of folks who are renters, and we have great renters, we have some not so great renters. We have homeowners who are renting, we have some homeowners not so great. But we are here because we want to make sure we have home ownership in the city of Detroit. And I want to bring forward Mr. Donnell Covey. Y'all give it up. Covey. And he's with NAPA, and that stands for the Neighborhood Assistance Corporation of America. And just to give you a little background there, they started in 1988. Lenders are advocates against predatory and discriminatory lenders, as well as providing the best mortgage program in America. We have had up to this point $13 billion in funding.
$13 billion.
And the goal is to build strong, healthy neighborhoods in urban and rural areas nationwide throughout affordable home ownership. You all give it up to Mr. Donnell Covey.
Thank you. Thank you. Everybody doing okay today?
Yeah.
You doing okay today?
Yeah.
All right. So, as he said, we started in 1988 fighting predatory lending. So if you look us up, you'll see videos of us fighting, marching against CEOs, at their houses, at their offices, things like that. But all that marching got us here today where we can offer a mortgage to low to moderate income people with $0. We don't look at your credit score, and you don't have any closing costs. How many believe that? Nobody believes it. That's because you heard that you have to have those things to get a house, right? To be a homeowner, right? That's what they tell you out there. So let me ask you a question. You heard of the housing crash, right? A lot of people lost their house. Do you think any of those had excellent credit? They still lost their home? Okay. Do you think any of those put a down payment down and still lost their home? The reason they lost their home is because they couldn't afford it. At some point, they couldn't afford the payment. Credit score doesn't determine if you're going to pay your mortgage or not. You can have a 700 credit score, but you lose your job. That credit score is not going to pay your mortgage. You can put down 20%. You still will lose your house if you can't make the payment. So why would we require you to do those things? All we care about is if you're going to pay the payment. So we focus on affordable payments. We look at your budget. We look at your income. We have what I call the five buckets. And I'm going to go through them really quick, but I got a special treat for you. Normally when I do my workshops, I'll speak for about 3.5-4 hours, but I don't have that kind of time today. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through my five buckets and tell you how to qualify. And then I'm going to bring up, for those of you who didn't raise your hand, that this actually works. I have some NACA members who I actually closed. One of them is actually a District 1 homeowner using the NACA mortgage. So, five buckets. I'm going to go through them really quick. One is eligibility. You have to be eligible for this program, which means you cannot be an investor. It's a primary home ownership program. So you have to utilize this house as your primary residence. If you own any other homes, you either have to sell them. Unless it's inherited, we won't make you give away your family home. Another thing to be eligible, you cannot work for a payday loan company. Anybody know why?
Predatory.
Exactly. Payday loan companies are predatory. We will not give you this type of loan without any predatory terms if you're out in the community giving out predatory loans. Other than that, you'll qualify. You can fill my first bucket. Second bucket, payment history. Now, I did say we don't look at credit score, but we do look at your credits. We look at your payment history. But we are a character-based lender. We will make exceptions if it makes sense. So our guideline, 12 months on time payments. If you have late payments within that 12 months, you have a good reason, lost a job, health issues, anything like that, that's a good exception for us. That's a good reason for us, and we'll make that exception. So, on-time payments for the last 12 months were a good exception. I have a good explanation of why you don't have it. You can fill my second bucket. Third bucket, stable income. Have to have a stable income. When I say stable income, it's not just your W-2 job. We'll take Social Security, disability, pension, child support if it's court ordered. Anything that you can document when you make your income, you're good with us. Self-employed as well. We actually would do a cash flow analysis if you're that type of self-employed person that writes off a lot on your taxes. Other companies won't do that for you. But we know you make more money than you tell our family. So we look at your cash flow analysis. What bucket am I on? Three? Four? Four? Okay, fourth bucket is affordable payments. After we look at what you make, we look at your debt, and we'll say, okay, based on that, you qualify for a certain payment. If that payment gets you what you want, where you want to live, what you desire, then you're good. If it doesn't, we'll work with you with budget counseling, things like that, to see how we can get you there. But once we find an affordable payment for you, you're good. You can fill that fourth bucket. Fifth bucket, compliance. All that means is you have the paperwork to back it up. If I wanted to borrow $100,000 from you guys, what would you want from me? Would you just give it to me, right? You got a need, you want to know where I work. I can't just tell you where I work. You're going to want to know, okay, let me see some documentation, right? Same thing. So think about it like that. If somebody's going to ask you to borrow some money, the things that you would want from them, what would you want from me? So my fifth bucket is just basically compliance. You have your paperwork to back it up. Your W-2s, tax returns, check stubs, all that good stuff. Okay? How many believe this program actually works for what I just said? Still no hands. Wow. Got a few back there. Got a few back there. So let me do this. I'm going to bring up some people who actually used the program. Zero down. We did look at their credit score, and they still got a low interest rate. Everyone gets the same low interest rate. Today's rate is 4.125. So I don't care if your credit score is a 500 or 750, you're gonna get the same score. Because it doesn't make sense because you have a lower credit score, you get a higher interest rate. Doesn't make sense to us. So, my NACA members, Mr. Enoch Young, Mr. Joseph Armstrong, and I didn't know he was gonna be here. You raise your hand, I can't see you, but if you're a NACA member, come on up. And Officer Coleman, I had no idea he would be here. He's actually a NACA member who brought the city of Detroit as well. Alexander Plum? Yes. So, I'm just going to turn this mic over to them and let you see that this program actually works. Okay? Joseph Armstrong, just give him a little bit.
How y'all doing? Everything he's telling you is exactly what the program is for me. I get in, I'm in the Grand Mount Rosedale Park area. I got in at 4%, and the process for me was lengthy because of my situation, but the close, and that's another thing I wanted to thank you. I didn't get to thank you at my close for everything that you've done, because he took over my case and made sure everything was up to par. So I got the house that I wanted, that I loved, and thanks to kind of my realtor through NACA. It was just an easy situation. All of no fees, all of that is true. Advise the next time he asks you the question, everybody raise their hand.
Thank you. And you're welcome. Enoch Young.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Enoch. This is Jed. This is Jire. The program works. Everything he said is true. I don't live in District 1. I live over in the Oakland area, so don't wait. That's one thing I would say. If you're looking for a house, don't wait. I mean, if you're behind, you think you're behind, don't worry about none of that. Go up there, Darnell will take care of you. Actually, Darnell came, and I think we had acceptance on like six houses, and Darnell came like in the middle of it. Darnell actually stepped in and took our case over. making sure everything got taken care of. We closed because of Darnell. Now, we did have another counselor. He did a lot of work. We closed because of Darnell. Darnell will take care of everything. The counselors there are wonderful. Interest rates are low. And, I mean, you're going to have a house. Just be patient. And this one thing, too. Even if you don't get your house through NACA, NACA sets you up to be ready to walk to another place. And they want to be upset if you don't close the NACA. And that was a good thing for us. We could have went somewhere else, but we, you know, stayed stuck it out with NACA, and now we have a home. And thanks to Donnell as well.
Thank you. Alexander Plum.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I can't compete. I don't have kids. So they say that my generation is going to be the poorest generation. We're going to have the most debt. I went to college, I got a master's degree, and I have a godforsaken amount of money that I owe Uncle Sam because of all that. And so I didn't think it would ever be possible for me to be able to buy a house. But I moved back to Detroit after grad school, and I wanted to be part of the city, wanted to be part of something bigger, and so NACA allowed me to be able to do that. I think the biggest thing that NACA does is give someone like me who's never experienced home ownership, who's only ever rented with friends, just the knowledge of how to go about the whole process. I mean, you folks have got a lot more life experience than I do, and you're probably a lot smarter than I am. I had no clue where to start, and NACA really walks you slowly through that process. And so over maybe the year it took me to build up that little bit of savings I needed to be able to cover those shock things that come up out of the blue, I was building confidence. I was having someone walk through that process with me and help me navigate what it would look like to buy a house. So a year ago, I closed on my house in the Jefferson Chalmers neighborhood on the east side. And I could have done it. I could have done it without NACA. I don't know where I would be. I guess I'd probably still be renting somewhere. But now this is my opportunity as I make those little loan payments back to the bank or whatever to have my piece of the pie. And so I really give them a ton of credit for that and encourage you to check them out. Thanks.
Okay, I'm gonna have Officer Coleman come up. Process because I live in a beautiful home. It's in District 1, Sand Hills community. It's right by Romeo Golf Course. So I just look at it every day and say, I don't know how I got this house, but I do know how I got the house because they blessed me to get the house. But what I tried from the very beginning, I never tried to establish credit. I've been buying things for cash for years and saving money to buy things. So I just had no credit. And they showed me how to get my credit up. And I just feel like God blessed me. I wanted to stay in Detroit. I did not want to leave. I wanted to go to Rosedale, but the house I found fits Rosedale, but it's in the Sand Hills community. I'm just thankful and I'm blessed. If you can take time and try to find yourself a way to get a house and pray on it, NACA can help you get it. I look at my house and I know I'm supposed to be paying a whole lot more money, but I'm paying a note that's way more than when I was renting a smaller house. So I was blessed enough to buy the house I was renting, as well as the house they blessed me to buy. That's the blessing. Thank you, Dr. Coleman. I have one more person, and then we're going to wrap it up. Last but not least is Ms. Jasmine Reed.
I did go to the workshop. I went to one in Pontiac. You have to sit through the whole thing in order to get credit and move forward and make an appointment with NACA. You do have to provide a lot of information. One of the things is it really helps you focus on what's actually on your credit. So even though they don't look at the score, you do get to kind of look and see what's actually on your credit and work on those things so you can get approved for more money. So it really did push me to do that. We closed in February. We bought a house in Martin Park. I have a really low interest rate. And the way that it's set up is that you can't be approved for anything that is not affordable. It won't, there's no way it won't let you. With a lot of consultation, with each house you choose. Say, I want to close on this house. Your mortgage consultant will say you can afford it or you can't afford it. So that it can't be set up to fail in any kind of way. It's not set up that way. So it's been a great process. And so when he reached out and asked, of course I was like, yes, of course, because I want people to see that it is real. You can do it. I closed with $2,600. Most people you know probably close with about $10,000 for closing costs. So I closed with $2,600. So, and that was it. So thank you.
Give all my happy a hand real quick. I got one more that showed up, but we're good. Tarita Ingram. Tarita Ingram.
Okay, so I'm 1 year into my house, or my condo. I live just east of downtown, Elmwood Park neighborhood. Process. So it's a lot of paperwork. And I also think that it's always not timely, right? So I'm like, oh, we need something back. I told you I ate anything before I lived in today. So that gets a little bit of a hassle. There's no, like, you don't need a down, because I was in a position where I had either down payment money or closing cost money, not both. So I was able to not need a down payment, which is a big saver because bank regulations are a lot tighter. You do need that 20%. So going through that, I mean, I didn't have to worry about that. All I needed money was for my association, my taxes, and my insurance to close on it. I always tell everybody because I knew where I wanted to live, I found the house shopping process a little bit more frustrating than the actual NAFTA process. My court counselor was Ortez. He's amazing. He's a straightforward guy, a little harsh, but I'd rather have you be straightforward with me than be nice any day. So I like that. And I think my biggest qualm with me is that I was debating about whether or not I wanted to buy, was it the right time for me? And then it just became a point where I dragged it out like 3 months, because once I submitted all my paperwork, I was approved like a month later and was ready to start shopping. So I felt like I would have been dragging my feet. I could have been in my home a little bit sooner, maybe got it for a little bit of a less price, but I would drag my feet. I did that myself. I didn't think everybody should do it. I tell all my friends. I work for Ford, and I do a financial workshop with the interns, and I brought up the NACA program because I think for young black professionals, if you're in a position where you're stable to buy, this is a great program to help you. But I also think it's for everybody. Anybody can then help walk you through the process, and that's actually on your side versus banks have their own agenda. Realtors have their own agenda. NACA's job is to help you get in the house. That's what their goal is. And they want to keep you there. So that's why it's important that it's affordable. And, you know, I'm one of those millennials with a ton of student loans, so I can still afford to pay my student loans and all my other expenses and afford my house. So that's great.
Thank you. Okay, I'm going to wrap this up because I don't have much time. But we have some flyers in the back for our next workshop. That's our first step to become a NACA member, is to go to the workshop. We will not put you in a home that you will lose. That is our biggest thing. We do not want you to lose a home. No one should ever have to lose their home because they can't afford to pay. Okay? You guys enjoy the rest of your day. Don't give it up. So in 1988, our CEO felt like, well, anybody know what redlining is?
Yes.
They take this map and they put this red marker and they say either we're not going to lend there, or if we lend there, we're going to give them higher rates. Our CEO, Bruce Marks, did not like that. So predatory lending, PMI, charging people, you know, for paying the loan off early, things like that, we fought against that. We fought against that so hard where we said, well, why don't we just loan our own money and do it the right way? So that's how we came about. We don't want you guys to have to worry about losing your house because of predatory lending. All right, so we're going to open up for some Q&A. I'm sure we got some questions.
God, I'm not sure if you provide this or not, but there are a lot of people buying houses because of the, you know, revitalization program the mayor's put together that can afford to get the house, but maybe not afford to even be able to do all the upkeep or the things to bring the house to code or things that make the house more habitable, you know, facility they want to be in. Do you provide those kinds of financing as well?
So, we will allow you to purchase the home and use funds to rehab. We had a lot of people who bought land bank properties, $1,000, a couple thousand dollars, and they come to us for the money to rehab it. So we will roll that all into one loan. So you can go in, buy the house, and fix it up as long as it fits within your affordability. If you already own the house, we can do that as well. All the funds that you use will only be for rehab. You can't take any cash out and you go buy your car or something like that. But yeah, we're helping you rehab on your home that you already own as well. We have some great in-house agents. So if you don't have a real estate agent, you can come to us. We have two in-house agents. One of them is sitting here, Connie Carham. She's excellent. Any other questions?
Yep, we have one from the right over here.
Question.
Can you upgrade from being you're
already a homeowner
and you want to see some other property?
Yes, you can upgrade if you want to move into another property using active mortgage. You just have to have that home that you own now sold before you close with an active mortgage because you can't own two homes. So we do a 15-year and a 30-year, but you can pay it off at any time with no prepayment penalty.
So baby, we want to thank you for dropping by the District 1 of the United. She came down to the very information for this testimony. So that's how we need to have these folks come. So we got someone here who didn't think was going to be able to be here today, but he is here to join us. We're going to bring up Mr. David Kalata of Happy Howie's, and he has his bodyguard with him today, the owner of Happy Howie's. He's able to come by and join us today.
Hi, everyone. Good morning. Yeah, I really didn't think I was going to be able to make it, but I got a last-minute change of plans, so I thought it was definitely important to come down and hopefully pass the presentation, but I missed it. How did patients do, everyone?
She did great.
Thank you, patients. Patients has a fantastic story with Happy Howie. She's been with us for 3, going on 4 years now. She started off working in our packaging department and really got her hands dirty, even making the treats, dealing with the raw meat, and she really excelled through it all. And now she is my colleague, a really close partner of mine, helps us with customer service questions, supporting our sales team, accounting, bookkeeping. So, you know, round of applause for patients. Thank you so much. Now, Councilman, are there any questions that she knocked it up? You know, the one thing that I will add is, you know, I'm really excited about our company and our team. We're very passionate about the community. And I can assure you guys are going to hear a lot of great stories coming from us for many, many years to come. You know, we're here, we're committed to the community, we're cleaning up our area. So just, you know, keep an eye on us and you'll see us do great things. Thank you.
Thank you for your investment in District 1. Appreciate you coming by. How are you doing? All right, so we're at that point. Sometimes people ask, what have you been doing since the last council session, since the last time that we met? And my job downtown also involves the legislative stuff. This is community, so we want to make sure that these meetings are not just one thing, not just two things, but it's to give you a more full example of what we do in District 1. So I want to bring forward Mr. DeAndre Watson. Look at the entire team. A round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. D1, D2. A great job. So DeAndre, you talked about this week we had just 2 days ago. a public hearing on medical marijuana. I know we talk about that a lot here in District 4, but I want to make sure that you all know exactly what's going on, and not from what you hear in the paper or what you read in the papers. What you hear on the streets, you get it directly from the folks who are actually making it happen legislatively. And this gentleman has been very, very intricately involved in the process. So he's going to give you a legislative update on where we are with the medical marijuana ordinance. DeAndre Watson.
Thank you. Good morning. I don't have to rush like I did the last time. I actually have some time to go over to this in detail. So first, how many of you are already familiar with the medical marijuana zoning ordinance that is going through the legislative process? All right, I see a lot of hands. So I won't spend too much time doing an overview of what it says. I'll just let you know, for those of you who didn't raise your hand, that Councilman Tate has been the lead legislative authority on medical marijuana from the beginning. So we owe him a debt of gratitude for all of his hard work and his leadership. We are at the stage now where the city is in a position to implement yet another medical marijuana ordinance to deal with zoning regulations for the different medical marijuana facilities that have been created under this new state law. So I know all of you are familiar with what we've been calling medical marijuana caregiver centers, which are places where registered patients and caregivers can transact business for medical marijuana purposes in a commercial setting in the city. Those caregiver centers are a creation of the city of Detroit. They don't exist in statewide legislation. They were created by the city so that we could regulate medical marijuana activity in Detroit so we could deal with the situation we had where there were over 200 dispensaries throughout the city with no rules or regulations to govern them. We are past that point now. The state has adopted a comprehensive set of regulations for medical marijuana across the state. That law is called the Medical Marijuana Facilities Licensing Act. Again, that's the Medical Marijuana Facilities Licensing Act. Under that law, there are five different types of medical marijuana facilities that are allowed to operate in the state of Michigan. Those are provisioning centers, which are basically the retail dispensaries for medical marijuana. There are also grower facilities, where the medical marijuana is grown. There's also processing facilities where the raw medical marijuana plant is processed and turned into some form of use, whether it's smokable or edible. There's also the safety compliance facilities, which are the testing labs for medical marijuana. And then there are secure transporter facilities, which are places or entities that transport the marijuana products between those other four uses. The city of Detroit has already opted into the commercial statewide medical marijuana program through a ballot initiative that was on the ballot last year. So all five licenses are authorized to exist in the city of Detroit. But before that can happen, we have to have rules in place to determine where they can be located and how they can operate inside the city of Detroit. So the zoning ordinance that is going through the process right now is designed to do just that. So 2 days ago, on Thursday morning, in Councilman Tate's Planning and Economic Development Standing Committee, there was a public hearing on the proposed zoning ordinance to determine where these five license types can exist in the city of Detroit. The last time I was before you, I gave you an update and told you that the City Planning Commission, which is the City Zoning Commission, forwarded a recommendation on some changes to the ordinance that Councilman Tate originally submitted to them for their review and recommendation. One of the things that they changed was they added entities to what we're calling a medical marijuana facility review committee. Because every single last one of these license types are going to be called conditional uses, which means that none of them will be allowed to operate in the city of Detroit without first going through a public hearing process where you all will be notified and invited down to come and attest to whether that particular use should be allowed in your specific area, and if so, on what terms and conditions. So because they're all conditional uses, they're all going to go through a special land use hearing. And they're going to be forwarded to what's called the Medical Marijuana Facility Review Committee, which is going to look at every single application on an individual basis and make sure that everything that needs to be part of the application process is part of it, that all of the I's are dotted and all of the T's are crossed. So the City Planning Commission recommended that we also include among the Assessors Department, the Law Department, the Police Department, City Planning Commission. In addition to all of those departments, the City Planning Commission also recommended that we include the Fire Department, the Department of Public Works,
and those uses were added to the facility review committee. They also recommended that we allow grower facilities to be larger than what was originally proposed. The original proposal called for 15,000 square feet as a maximum building footprint for grower facilities on land that was no larger than 1 acre in size. That's been changed to now be 30,000 square feet on land no larger than 3 acres in size. Those changes were already part of the process when we got to the hearing on Thursday. So what I'm about to tell you now is hot off the press. This language hasn't even been added to the ordinance yet, so you are the first group hearing this information. And I don't want you to have to write this down, so I want to let you know we are going to send this out to you via email. So if you didn't sign in when you got here, make sure you sign in before you leave, because we're going to use that information to make sure that you get this update electronically. But there were 7 changes that were made during the public hearing process on Thursday. The first change was that a definition for co-location was added to the ordinance. And that's important because the ordinance allows for multiple license types to be located in a single space. So you can have a provision center, a processor facility, and a grower facility all in one building so that you don't have to have them spread out throughout the city and people are transporting marijuana everywhere. They can have their entire operation in one spot. The definition for co-location was added so that we can make it clear that while, yes, you can have multiple medical marijuana facilities in one location, that does not mean that you can also have a dispensary / McDonald's or a dispensary / Starbucks or Starbucks or anything like that. So the definition was added to make that clear. The second change that was made, I talked about the restriction on grower facilities being limited to a building with a footprint, which means the entire building cannot be larger than 30,000 square feet on a parcel larger than 3 acres in size. That does not mean that you can't grow vertically. So if someone wants to have 2 or 3 stories, they can have a vertical operation, but they can't expand on the ground floor beyond 30,000 square feet. There was a change made on Thursday, however, because we talked about the co-location, to make sure that in the event that somebody does have multiple medical marijuana facility licenses in one spot, they are allowed to go beyond that 30,000 square foot maximum for that particular site. But it is capped at 50,000 square feet. So the language basically says that if you're a grower facility, you're limited to 30,000 square feet on a parcel larger than 3 acres in size. However, if you are co-located with other medical marijuana facility license types, then you're allowed to go up to 50,000 square feet on a parcel no larger than 5 acres in size. The third change that was made is that the law department, who chairs the Medical Marijuana Facility Review Committee, which is the body that's going to look at every single application that comes through to the city, is going to be required to submit a report to City Council that lists the department, the name, title, and contact information for each member that's appointed review committee and every alternate member that's appointed to the review committee so that there's transparency about who the people are who are reviewing these applications and how people can get in contact with them. The fourth change that was made is that language was added to the ordinance to require the Building Safety Engineering and Environmental Department, or BC for short, to consistently update its website with the location of all medical marijuana facilities that have been licensed by the state of Michigan. So that way everybody in the public has an opportunity to go to that website and you can see every single authorized medical marijuana facility that is operating. That lets you know who's legal, and it also allows you to determine who's not legal if they're not listed on that website. The fifth change that was made was that there was a correction to clarify that secure transporter facilities are subject to the drug free zone restriction, which means that 4 of the 5 license types, with the exception of the testing labs, are not allowed in drug free zones. So we know drug free zones include schools, playgrounds, public housing facilities, educational institutions, and the like. The sixth change, I'm almost finished. The sixth change that was made is that the clustering for medical marijuana Michigan centers and caregiver centers that was allowed in industrial areas has been removed. So now medical marijuana caregiver centers and provisioning centers have to be at least 1,000 feet away from each other, period. There's no more allowance for them to be clustered in industrial areas as there was before. And the last change is that additional review criteria was added to the facility review committee that includes looking at health impacts, truck routes, and the blight violation history for the applicant and the property that is subject to the medical marijuana facility review application. So those seven changes were all approved during the public hearing process at the Planning and Economic Development Standing Committee. What's going to happen now is that the ordinance with these amendments incorporated will be on the agenda on Tuesday for the entire city council to make a final vote. Assuming that that is approved on Tuesday, the administration has already requested that we use an October 1st effective date for the ordinance, which means that applications will be available and they will begin to be processed this fall in early October. So that is what happened on Thursday. That's where we stand again. Tuesday is the day where this ordinance is going to be considered by the entire body, and that we will have a new zoning ordinance and we can start moving forward with the commercial medical marijuana operation in Detroit. So if you go to DetroitMI.gov and you go to the government tab, you scroll down to city council, there's a link there that says watch council sessions live. So you'll be able to watch the actual formal session on Tuesday. And then if you go to the archive section, you can also view the entire public hearing that took place Thursday during the Planning and Economic Development Standing Committee there as well.
Have they limited how many of these facilities can be within Detroit?
Yes. So the proposed ordinance limits the provisioning centers to 75 sites. And to add some context to that, before there was an ordinance in place, there were close to 300 dispensaries throughout the city of Detroit. And after the ordinance that Council State Sponsor was put in place and through a coordination between the building department and police department, we've gotten that down from close to 300 down to about 57 operating sites in the city of Detroit. So the 75 cap includes the 57 that are already operating. And then there are also 70 sites that have been zoned for medical marijuana already. All 70 of those sites have gone to the state so they can start the state application process. So there are really only 5 more sites available for medical marijuana under the new ordinance, assuming that all of those folks who went through the state process actually get approved. So there are a total of 75 provisioning center sites allowed under the proposed ordinance.
We have one over here.
Thank you, we know that the council is involved in this discussion going back to 2014. Now, you know we voters are going to have a chance to bid in on recreation. How is that going to pan out with all the changes? And it took those 4 years to get where we are, and I'm most impressed. So if we voters vote to have recreation, then what happens to the proposals that you discussed?
Glad you asked.
That's a good question. Recreational marijuana has virtually nothing to do with what's currently being proposed today. But with that being said, the current medical marijuana framework, the recreational ballot initiative is designed to fit within the current medical marijuana framework. But it doesn't mean that anything that happens today in Detroit will automatically be able to transfer to recreational marijuana. That's not the case. So we would need to have another ordinance put in place, or at least modify the ordinance that we have in place, or that we're putting in place today, to accommodate recreational marijuana, assuming that it actually is approved. But today's action is not related to recreational marijuana.
We have one here.
In some states, people have probably put in their money in the bank. Would the people in Detroit have the same kind of problem?
Yeah, that's a national issue. So the medical marijuana industry in states across the country, we all have a very similar challenge with operating with banks that are regulated by the federal government, because the federal government still considers marijuana illegal on its face, which is part of the reason why the state of Michigan has created a secure transporter license type, so that the cash and the other products are transported by licensed, armed, and bonded folks who can license by the state to do just that.
Got one here?
I think I understood you to say that. I thought I understood you to say that there would be a limit of 75 of these provisioning centers within the city?
That's correct.
Okay. My question relates to areas of the city. Is there any limit in terms of the number within a certain area? There seems to be a great deal of them that are on the 8 Mile road area. How many are we allowed to have in different areas of the city?
Part of the reason why you see so many along 8 Mile, one is because the previous ordinance allowed caregiver centers to be clustered in industrial areas. And a lot of 8 Mile is known as industrial. So that's part of the reason why you see so many along 8 Mile. The revised ordinance that will be up for a vote on Tuesday will not allow clustering in industrial areas. So that will address that issue. The second piece is that the Board of Zoning Appeals was empowered to grant spacing variances that allow individual applicants to ignore the spacing requirements under the ordinance by getting a variance. This ordinance that will be up for vote on Tuesday also removes that provision. So if you're not 1,000 feet away from another provisioning center, you will not be allowed to obtain a license. If you're 999 feet away, you will not be allowed to obtain a license. Nope. That's the way this ordinance reads today. So that should address those issues that you just brought up.
And we have one over here.
And so my question kind of leads you back off that a little bit. So if there are more than 75 today in existence, what would be the process to shut down the ones that are operating outside of the proposed ordinance, like within the less than 1,000 square feet, or if there are multiple ones in the industrial area? What would that process look like to take those down?
Yeah, the enforcement, talk a little bit about the enforcement team that's out there that wasn't there for sure when this whole thing began, when there were no rules and regulations.
So, one, the police department and the building safety, engineering, and environmental department have been coordinating throughout the city to issue correction orders to locations that are operating without a license, particularly the ones that are operating in drug-free zones, because those that are in drug-free zones have no path forward for a license, because there are no waivers that are allowed for drug-free zone restrictions. The other piece, which is also good to hear, is that because now medical marijuana facilities are state-licensed facilities, the state police have joined that effort, and the state police are also conducting enforcement activities against illegally operating medical marijuana facilities. So if you have a facility that you are aware of that should not be operated, or you have questions about whether something should be operated, you can always call 224-DOPE. That's D as in Delta, O-P-E as in Echo. 224-DOPE is the city's hotline for illegal medical marijuana activity. You can also contact the Building Safety, Engineering, and Environmental Department, your neighborhood police officer, and you can definitely always contact the Office of Councilman Tate as well. We have BC and DPD working together to address illegally operating facilities. The state's Bureau of Medical Marijuana Regulation and the state police will be joining that effort. I think they sent out about 156 cease and desist letters to the legally operating facilities from the state level, to let them know that the state police is aware they're operating illegally and they have to shut down or face state action. So enforcement activity is ongoing, and once this ordinance is put in place, any facility that's operating outside of the realm of these regulations will be dealt with the same way.
All right. Y'all give it up for the end of the conversation.
Starting off with a burden, you know, already where it's obstacles that are blocking them from getting a quality education. And I just want to say this, piggybacking off of Annie for GOTV, it is so important that we get out and vote. I think the majority of people in here are already voting, may have already voted, but it is really important that we spread the word. Each of us should at least try to encourage 5 to 10 people that we know of to come out and vote. The Democratic Party is so broken. In a house that's divided, it cannot win. But you know what? It can fall, and we keep falling into the losing pool. And it's time to stop. We need to come together, support a candidate that already has solutions to our issues, not asking you to vote for them, and when they get in the office, they'll see what they can do. Vote Abdul El Sayed. Thank you.
And the flyers on the back table.
Hi, my name is Kimberly Hilna, and I am actually running for Congress in the 13th Congressional District. And I'm running for 3 reasons. One, because I care about the district, I care about the issues, I care about the future of the district. I understand many of the issues that are concerning this district when you talk about infrastructure support. President Trump has a $1.5 trillion infrastructure plan. What would happen if we had a comprehensive infrastructure plan that not only focused on roads and bridges, but also focused on updating our water system, updating our electrical grid so we can stop having all of these power outages, dealt with transportation, and a number of other issues. I also understand the workforce skills gap. In the state of Michigan, there are over 104,000 jobs. But in many of our urban cities, particularly throughout the 13th Congressional District and statewide, we have a very high unreported unemployment rate. As a member of Congress, one of the things that I will do is work to bring money back to the district to fund local job training agencies so that they can actually put people to work. Looking at also education, access to Head Start, it has already been reported that children who do not have access to Head Start, once they start school, they are automatically left behind. Those are just a few of the issues that I will be focusing on. And of course, I cannot stop without saying I will be focusing on the environment. In 2013, I was actually acknowledged by the President Obama's administration because of my work on clean air and climate change. So my name is Kimberly Hill-Knott. I've worked for John Conyers for over a decade, and I'm ready to take that experience as a congressional staffer, as an entrepreneur, and as someone who has a background in environmental justice to Washington, D.C. I am a write-in candidate only because I didn't quite get enough signatures to get my name on the ballot. But I didn't quit, and I didn't quit because I still care, I still understand, and I am still ready to get the job done. Please remember, Kimberly Hill-Knott, write-in Hillary. Thank you.
Good morning, or afternoon. My name is Madison Abrams. I'm the founder and CEO of Aesthetic Beauty and Essentials, which is a nature-inspired, eco-friendly company. I'm 15 years old, and I've also started, my family has lived back to Detroit in the Brightmoor District for about 5 or 6 years. And I started this company because my mothers have had severe food allergies, and we've been allergic to either nickels and dyes and creams, and I just wanted to have bracelets and soaps and creams that I can use and I can trust within them. All the bracelet, jewelry, the things that I wear, I make myself. We have some soaps over here that I also just have assistance from my beautiful mother right here. I've also had a pop-up shop that started in Capitol Park and around the Bedrock District in downtown Detroit. And I've Austin's very, very excited for this. I'll be there for 2 weeks. July.
I'm gonna help you.
She actually was a feature vendor at the Capitol Park downtown markets from June 30th, July 30th, I'm sorry, to August 12th. So if you guys are in the downtown area, come and visit Madison and say you can be central. Thank you guys.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm MPO Chili from Detroit Police Department, 8th Precinct. On the back table, we have some flyers. We would like to invite everybody out to our National Night Out. This is the 35th year that we're celebrating. National Night Out is a national event that's celebrated the first Tuesday of August in the entire nation, with the exception of Texas, and that's because it's too hot. They celebrate in October. This is a free event. This year we held at Crowell Recreational Center, which is right behind the Great Lakes Precinct. It's from 5 to 8. It's a free food, hamburgers, hot dogs, potato chips, teddy zoo, pony rides, bounce houses, characters for the young children to take pictures with, dance with. We're going to have live jazz and just a fun-filled evening. Once again, it is August the 7th from 5 to 8 at Crowell Recreational Center, and it is 100% free. And waiting in line, I was overhearing the young lady that was just speaking with her mom, and we have invited her to come up and showcase her items as well. So there we go. So we hope to see you guys. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well,
as I said, it was well worth the wait.
Hi, my name is Steve Fair from Grand Center, Detroit. We're working just north of 7 Mile, between Telegraph and Five Points, working to bring a lot of transformation to a neighborhood. I see my friend Jacqueline over there, so you heard her spotlighted a couple months ago at the D1 meeting. And so I wanted to share with you, we are pleased that we got chosen for a Kaboom Park grant. So I don't know if you've ever heard of the organization called Kaboom, but they put parks in all over the country. And so we're putting a 2,500 square foot playscape in just on Lenora Avenue. And so we need a lot of volunteers to come help. It'll go up in one day on September 15th. We also need people that are interested in financially supporting this. Obviously, we have to do our part in supporting some of it and paying for some of the playscape. But we have these brochures in the back as well. And if you're a part of an organization, you want to find out more about it, come and talk to me, because I'll get you a folder with more information about Grand 7 Detroit and what we're doing. So, thank you.
Some of you the same way I know I am. They are angry about this insurance, and they can't buy a car, they can't buy a car, pay the insurance, don't too. And we don't have to do something about that. And I think we can do it because we're very smart. Now, I got this thing here. I want you, if you're association president, block club person, we got a board, I want you to sign this and we will get in touch with you when we have the meeting, because we got 200 or 300 signatures already. So, and my phone number is 835-7170. And my name is Hardy, Barbara Hardy. So you sign this, we'll get in touch, you put your name and phone number. We're using that for business, no fool.
She'll be in the back, let me see.
Show them we're not.
Yes, ma'am, yes, ma'am. Barbara, please.
Yeah.
also have a national night out at the 6th precinct. This year is going to be held at Brennan Pool. So it's going to be free swimming for the kids. We got also have free food, music, box towns, and everything that the kids can enjoy. So if you're over in the south end, you can stop by the 6th precinct. If you're in the north end, you can stop by the 8th precinct. Both of them are great events, and we hope to see you there.
All for your charge.
Hey everybody, is that loud?
550 Burt Road, I'm sorry. The meeting is from 6 to 8:30. We really need to hear from the community in terms of what's happening in your neighborhoods. I need your block clubs, your corners, and get your ideas and your input on what we can do to end or reduce the gun violence in our district. Am I the only one that's tired? Every day you turn on the news, you hear about someone passing away or being killed or murdered. Even babies finding guns and incidentally killing themselves. So we have to do something about it. If we don't do something, no one else is going to pay attention. So please, please, I have this flyer on the back. You'll be hearing more information from me. You'll be getting it by email. And if you want to talk to me afterwards, you can find me running around. Thank you. Oh, I'm sorry, the date and time this Wednesday, August 15th, from 6 to 8:30 p.m. at the McKinley Center, 19750 Burt Road.
Please be sure to mark your calendars. Before we got here, I want to make sure we announce our police officers are back. Give a round of applause, please. Thank you all for coming. Give yourself a round of applause. Oh, we thank the church, everybody. The historic St. James Missionary Catholic Church. Everyone, please, the comment cards on the table, please drop them off at the desk. Please take about 2 minutes to fill them out. We'd love to have your feedback, and please, 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 we'll see you on September 28th. Thank you.